Well, thank you all for coming in. Tuesday night, as you know, I spoke to the nation in the State of the Union address on our plans and hopes for the future. The document I'm about to sign here is, in a sense, a blueprint of those plans. Taken together, this message and the fiscal 87 budget that I submitted yesterday constitute a detailed declaration of our legislative and administrative agenda, an agenda for the future. I believe this document and the plans it contains reflect the basic and unchanging intentions of our administration to ensure the growth of an expanding economy, to see to it that every American who wants a job can get a job, and to keep in the hands of our citizens as much of their own earnings as we can. It repeats our intention to cut the growth of federal spending and thereby reduce the federal deficit. We'll continue to work with the Congress to produce tax reform that is really reform, and we'll also continue to pursue reform of our welfare system. In the area of foreign relations, we've made our goals clear. Continued harmony with our allies, renewed progress toward a more stable peace with our adversaries, and increased respect for human rights everywhere. We've also made it clear, and I'm eager to stress today, that our desire to cut the budget will not be allowed to collide with our need for a strong defense. Graham Rudman Hollings will be used as a shovel to dig us out of the results of deficit spending, but we will not allow it to be used as a cannon pointed at our real and legitimate defense needs. We've also made it clear that our commitment to help freedom fighters throughout the world continues unabated. We know what's happening in Afghanistan, Cambodia, Angola, and Nicaragua, and we support the efforts of those who continue, with little help from the world, to fight a lonely struggle against the enemies of freedom and human rights. Our commitments, our desires remain essentially unchanged from 1981. We expect our economic progress to continue. We expect a similar progress in a number of areas, from the search for a security shield to protect us from nuclear missiles, to encouraging real efforts at increasing economic freedom in the less advanced countries of the world. So now, I will sign this document. About that, I have a pen that writes more than one word. And I'm also happy to sign today the economic report of the President. It details the facts of a robust economy that will continue to grow. And before you go, I heard a reference to my age this morning. I've heard a lot of them recently. I did turn 75 today, but remember that's only 24 Celsius.
President, Tip O'Neill says your new budget is a disgrace, and he wants you to explain to the country why your top priority is to get to Tokyo in 2 hours.
That isn't a top priority. That is just another evidence that I've given that we are continuing with the progress that we've made in space and moving forward in fields of that kind in technology. I don't see anything disgraceful about a budget that is spending almost $1 trillion and yet at the same time is starting to move under the laws they adopted to balance the budget.
Now, he says that he would be willing to meet with you to work out a compromise, but he says he doesn't think it would do any good, that you don't want to compromise.
Well, I'm always happy to meet with Tip, and I'm looking forward to keeping in communication with members of the Congress, of the House, and the Senate. Yes. We've submitted the budget. It is there. The next step is theirs to see whether they what they want or don't want, but as I say, we've worked long months on this, and we believe it's a budget that will do what the law is asking us to do finally. And I think it'll behoove some who, for a quarter of a century or more, have been admittedly running deficits with no effort or intention at all to ever eliminate deficit spending.
The Democrats say it's dead on arrival, sir.
Well, they may have prejudged there. We'll give it artificial respiration.
Thanks, sir. Thank you.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Thank you.
How does it feel to be 75 years of age?
Well, Sam, the funny thing is, it seems only like 39 to me.
Well, you look 39, I'll say that.
You're my favorite fella. Thank you.
What do you want for a birthday present?
You made my day.
What would you like for a birthday present?
I kind of like some of these things that we're doing to be accomplished and further advances to peace. I don't have any other needs than that.
What about just personal thoughts when you realize that you've lived 3/4 of a century, Mr. President, more than a third of the nation's history?
Well, I don't know. Looking back on it, I'm a little amazed at our generation. And I make no apologies for them because I can well remember in my own mind that our generation has seen us move from the horse and buggy to a plane that we think can get to Tokyo in 2 hours, in a single lifetime.
But what is Mrs. Reagan giving you for your birthday?
The only thing I know is a party. No, we've, as I say, we sit down and talk about things that maybe we both mutually want when our birthdays such events come along anymore. So we haven't figured anything out yet.
You mean like a pickup truck or something?
That's it. Not bad. And, you know, the manure spreader is still new.
And we've already talked about Tip. I mean, that's not necessary. About Tip O'Neill.
Yeah. I'd like his, that would be a great present, his approval of everything we've done.
No coaching. Did Gorbachev send you a message? They read some messages, but they didn't mention one from Gorbachev.
Yes, I think there has been.
Birthday messages? I don't know.
I can't. I can't tell you. That package they gave me this morning, that gift, with 100 letters from heads of state throughout the world, and very obviously I haven't had time to just through the 100 letters yet.
Any thoughts on the Philippine election, which begins within hours?
Just only that the Philippines and the United States have had an historic friendship for many years, and we wanted to continue, and when they have made their decision, which is theirs to make, as to the future government, why, we will seek to go along with their decision and to maintain our relationship.
Mr. President, when you ran for office, you certainly made a lot of, you were very successful in large measure because you were so successful on television. I wonder how you feel about Mrs. Aquino not having the kind of access to Filipino television that you had to American television. Could you have won your election in 1980 without being able to get on television as frequently as you were?
Well, we'd like to see the whole world have the same democratic principles we do, but I don't think it's right for me to criticize their method of conducting the election.
Are you concerned their elections have already become tainted, Mr. President?
Again, I'm not going to comment on their internal affairs. I don't think it would be becoming of the head of state of another country to do so.
Well, how will you judge afterward whether those elections were free and fair?
That's up to the people of the Philippines to decide.
Well, we would still want to maintain our bases there under a new agreement, would we not, sir?
Yes, and as I say, when they've made their decision as to their government, the people of the Philippines, we would hope to have the continuing friendship and relationship that we've had for some time.
Because Mrs. Aquino has suggested that she won't promise in advance to renegotiate those base contracts.
Well, We'd have to deal with that then if she was in a position to have something to say about it.
Thank you, sir.
All right. All right.
Thank you.
Happy birthday.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
tricked you? I told him I blew up the candles this morning.